again to Emmanuel was not lovely. Would you agree with me tonight? I think they're getting better. Getting better. Not getting any younger, but they're getting better. And thank you so much again for your contribution to us this evening in our gospel service. It's great that we have Emmanuel, and it's great we have Impact Harmony and others tonight who help us out and who have a gift in this way. I want you to turn with me now to the Word of God. We're turning to the book of Genesis. And we're in Genesis chapter number 42, please. The book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 42. And we're going to commence reading from verse number 1. Genesis chapter 42, verse 1. Now when Jacob saw that there was corn in Egypt, Jacob said unto his sons, why do ye look one upon another? And he said, behold, I have heard that there is corn in Egypt. Get you down thither and buy for us from thence, that we may live and not die. And Joseph's 10 brethren went down to buy corn in Egypt. But Benjamin, Joseph's brother, Jacob sent not down with his brethren, for he said, lest peradventure mischief befall him. And the sons of Israel came to buy corn among those that came, for the famine was in the land of Canaan. And Joseph was the governor over the land. And he it was that sold to all the people of the land. And Joseph's brethren came and bowed down themselves before him with their faces to the earth. And Joseph saw his brethren, and he knew them, but made himself strange unto them, and spake roughly unto them. And he said unto them, whence come ye? And they said, from the land of Canaan to buy food. And Joseph knew his brethren, but they knew not him. And Joseph remembered the dreams which he dreamed of them, and said unto them, ye are spies, to see the nakedness of the land ye are come. And they said unto him, nay, my lord, but to buy food are thy servants come. We are all one man's sons. We are true men. Thy servants are no spies. And he said unto them, nay, but to see the nakedness of the land ye are come. And they said, thy servants are 12 brethren, the sons of one man in the land of Canaan. And behold, the youngest is this day with our father, and one is not. And Joseph said unto them, that is it that I spake unto you, saying, ye are spies. Hereby ye shall be proved. By the life of Pharaoh, ye shall not go forth thence except your youngest brother come hither. Send one of you and let him fetch your brother, and ye shall be kept in prison, that your words may be proved, whether there be any truth in you, or else by the life of Pharaoh, surely ye are spies. And he put them all together into ward 3 days. And Joseph said unto them the third day, this do and live, for I fear God. And if ye be true men, let one of your brethren be bound in the house of your prison. Go ye, carry corn for the famine to your houses, but bring your youngest brother unto me, and so shall your words be verified, and ye shall not die. And they did so. Now come with me down to verse number 29. And they came unto Jacob their father unto the land of Canaan, and told him all that befell them unto them, saying, the man who is the Lord of the land spake roughly to us, and took us for spies of the country. And we said unto him, we are true men, we are no spies. We be 12 brethren, sons of our father, one is not. And the youngest is this day with our father in the land of Canaan. And the man, the lord of the country, said unto us, Hereby shall I know that ye are true men. Leave one of your brethren here with me, and take food for the famine of your households, and be gone. And bring your youngest brother unto me, and then shall I know that ye are no spies, but that ye are true men. And so will I deliver your brother, and ye shall traffic in the land. Now come down to verse number 36. And Jacob their father said unto them, Me have ye bereaved of my children. Joseph is not, and Simeon is not, and ye will take Benjamin away. All these things are against me. And in verse 38 we read, And he said, My son shall not go down with you, for his brother is dead, and he is left alone. If mischief befall him by the way in the which ye go, then shall ye bring down my gray hairs with sorrow to the grave. And we know that the Lord will add his blessing to the reading from his own precious truth. When it comes tonight to a matter of life and death, the situation is serious, friends. Very, very serious. And when it comes to a matter of life and death, mind ye, you haven't a lot to come and go on. When it comes to a matter of life and death, because you see tonight, when it comes to a matter of life and death tonight, difficult choices have to be made. And some of those choices tonight will be very costly when it's a matter of life and death. In Boxing Day of 2004, when the great tsunami took place, a lady called Gillian Searle had one of those situations where she had to make a great choice. She was left holding on to her two sons as the floodwaters came swirling round her, holding on for grim death. And as she held on, Gillian Searle learned something. And this is what you learn. This is what became clear to her. She hadn't the strength to hold on to her two sons in order to survive. One of them was only two. The other one was five. The eldest was five. And she knew, in order to survive, she had a choice to make. If she was to live, she was going to have to let one of them go, or else the three perish. Gillian Searle desperately tried, and she knew that if she did not let one go, the three of them were going to die. She made the heartbreaking choice. And she let go of the eldest, who was only five. And she watched helplessly as the floodwaters carried the lad away. As a result, she and the youngest lived. But thank God, 3 hours later, the security person of the hotel where they were found the wee lad that was swept away and was brought back to his mother again. But that was a choice she had to make tonight in order to survive what you and I would term tonight a life and death situation. In this Bible reading tonight that we have read together in Genesis chapter 42, it's a matter of life and death. And Jacob says in verse number 2, "Behold, I've heard that there is corn in Egypt. Go you down thither and buy for us from thence, that we may live and not die." And you know the story as we read it together, how the 10 lads made their way down to Egypt. And Joseph, their brother, knew who they were. But Joseph was a stranger unto them. You know, friend, when I think about this tonight, the Lord Jesus Christ this evening knows who all about you, knows all about you, but he's a stranger to you this evening. He's a stranger to you. And the 10 brethren stand before Joseph, and Joseph speaks roughly with them. And he quizzes the 10 brethren as they stand there. And Joseph realizes that there's a younger brother back home. And Joseph tonight gives them a commandment. You're going to have to go back home again. And when you go back home again, you're going to have to bring the younger brother, Benjamin you call him, you're going to have to bring him down to me. That's what you're going to have to do, that if you're going to live. That's what you're going to do, or have to do, to prove tonight who you really are. And here's my text this evening. Comes from the words of Joseph. As Joseph speaks to the brethren, he says this in verse 18. "This do, and live, for I fear God." I want you to notice, first of all, the plea that is sounded in that text. It's simple. This do. Men, if you want to be saved, you're going to have to do what I tell you. You're going to have to bring Benjamin to me. I could almost feel the stomach of all those 10 men. How can we go and tell our father? He won't hear tell of it. He won't let the lad come down. And you remember what Joseph said when he said it. He said, "All these things are against me." The condition was clear. Bring Benjamin down. That's the condition. But Joseph said, or Jacob said, "All these things are against me." You see, it was against his idea. It was against his plan. It was against his demands. It was against his way of thinking. I'll tell you something now, unsafe friend. Joseph hadn't much to come and go on. This do. The plea that was sounded. And then Jacob complained. He said, these things are against me. Sometimes the way of salvation is like that tonight. The way of salvation's hard. The way of salvation may be against you tonight, against your beliefs. The way of salvation may be against your ideas. The way of salvation might be against your whole thoughts tonight, against your plans. Do you remember the rich young ruler? He knew he needed to be saved. He wanted eternal life. And when the Lord Jesus told him what to do, what the Lord Jesus said was against him. You know the way of salvation tonight? In many ways goes against the sinner. Because the first step to get onto the way of salvation, sinners has to acknowledge that they are a sinner. And many people don't like to acknowledge they're a sinner tonight. That goes against them. Wonder, does that go against you tonight? If you're ever going to be saved, you have to take this place tonight and confess and acknowledge you're a lost sinner. That's what you are tonight. You're not a Baptist at all. You're not a Presbyterian. You're not a Church of Ireland. You're not a Protestant. In God's sight, you're a lost sinner. And unless you acknowledge that first of all, you'll never be saved. No sinner will ever be saved until they acknowledge they're a sinner. Wonder, does that work against you tonight? All these things, Jacob said, are against me. And then you're to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. Maybe that goes against you as well. For many it does for a lot of people. A lot of good religious people in Kilkeel town tonight, this goes against them. Church going, yes. But this is against them this evening. The way of salvation runs against the grain, you see. But this is what you've got to do tonight. This do. And I plead with your never dying soul tonight. This do tonight. Will you acknowledge yourself as a lost sinner? This do tonight. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ tonight. This do. And I plead with your soul tonight. Oh, sinner friend, I plead with you. But maybe you're like the rich young ruler tonight. It's too costly. Maybe you're like Jacob tonight. He looks at the sun. And he says, in verse 38, my son shall not go down. The son was too precious to let go. You see, sinners see their sin like that tonight. For a lot of people, their sin's too precious to let go. They're drinking tonight. It's too precious to let go. There are drugs tonight. Too precious to let go. Your religious beliefs that you were brought up with, too precious to let go tonight. The plea that has sounded tonight is this do. Acknowledge you're a sinner this evening. This do tonight, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ tonight. This do, the plea that has sounded. Repent and believe this precious hour. Trust in the Savior's grace and power. Then will your joyous answer be saved through a long eternity. This do, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. This do tonight. Look unto me and be ye saved. This do tonight. This do. Because sinner friend, I can't make it any more easier and simpler. The plea that is sound. Look at that text, because you've got the prospect that is sure. Listen to what Joseph says. This do and live. Sinner friend tonight, why am I pleading with you to look to the Lord Jesus Christ? I'll tell you why. There's life for a look at the crucified one. There's life at this moment for you. Do you know what God wants you to know tonight, unsaved friend? God wants you to know tonight, you have every chance in getting saved. You have every chance this evening in getting right with God. You've every chance this evening to be assured of a place in heaven. Every chance. To know that sins are forgiven. Every chance to escape hell. Every chance to find peace with God. Every chance. You see, that's the prospect. That is sure to need. This do and live. You see, all hope tonight, all hope, it was pointing in their direction. And all hope tonight points in your direction. Thank God tonight there's hope for every sinner. This do. And live. You know, friend, tonight, this is why I preach in simple, clear language. That if any of you perish, your blood will not be at my door. Because every time I preach tonight, I want to make it as simple as I can, because it's too serious of a matter for preachers to complicate it. And you see, dear unsaved friend tonight, will you to leave tonight and live. Trust Christ tonight and live. You see, for you, sinner friend, tonight, it's not a matter of life and death. If that's all it was, it'll be all right. But for you tonight, it's more than a matter of life and death. It's a matter of heaven and hell. And I want to point you to the Lord Jesus tonight, who hung and bled and died on Calvary's cross. And I plead with you tonight to give these eternal matters great consideration. And I plead with you tonight, plead with you to seek Christ, because the Lord Jesus is the only Savior that there is, the only Savior that there ever was, the only Savior there ever will be, the Lord Jesus. Look at chapter 43, verse 1. It says, and the famine was sore in the land. I'll tell you, God was making things worse to waken them up, you know. God can sometimes squeeze the sinner hard to get him to awaken. Jacob said, my son shall not go down. But here's the lovely thing I see in the next chapter, verse number 11. If it must be so, now do this. You know what happened, poor old Jacob? I'm glad it happened. The consequences outweighed the cost. And now he's crying, if it must be so now. If it must be so. If it must be so. Now do this. Mark the word now. Because behold, now is the accepted time. Now is the day of salvation. I'm going to finish with the last point. And it is a point tonight. There's the plea that is sounded high. There's the prospect that is sure high. But there's the point that is solemn tonight. Because Joseph says, for I fear God. If I was in your shoes tonight, and you're not saved, I would take on board what God is saying. This do and live. How will you face God, sinner friend, tonight? If you were to die turning your back on his son, how would you face God tonight when you think of what God has done for you at Calvary? So that you could live. Right now, let me picture your soul. Your soul. Do you know where your immortal soul is right now? Your immortal soul right now is dangling over the very pit of hell. That's where your soul is right now. Do you know why your soul hasn't failed yet? Because the mercy of God is holding on to you. And someday God's mercy is going to let go. And down you'll go. The lost forever. You know what God is saying to you tonight? This do. and live. For what shall be the end of them who obey not the gospel of God? Sinner friend in him, this do and live, for I fear God. Let's pray. Lord, tonight we thank thee. Thou hast made it possible. Thou hast made us possible, Lord, made it possible for us to be saved. Help us, Lord, tonight to obey the call, to give up our sin and to give up our silly notions and trust Christ, who alone is the only Savior. Give grace tonight. Give faith tonight. Press hard tonight. We pray in his name. Amen. Our closing hymn tonight is 2.